This episode is brought to you from the Salesman.org HubSpot studio. Coming up on today's episode of the Salesman Podcast.
But the reality is, you're not going to buy from someone you don't like. You're not going to buy, you're definitely not going to buy from someone you don't trust. But the impact it has on traditional sales is even bigger. So when you do make calls, I mean, Will, I did something very similar recently where I was approaching a CEO of a very large global company. Salesloft as a company are now working with him to help support that continued personal brand growth. You see it with a lot of these micro influencers that are growing within these companies. And they're one of the best resources that companies have, where you get these creative people putting out content, and that is where the potential lies.
Hello, Sales Nation. My name is Will Barron, and I'm the host of the Salesman Podcast, the world's most downloaded B2B sales show. In today's episode, we have the king of social selling, Daniel Disney. He's my co-host on the Social Selling Show, which you can find over at salesman.org, as well as this episode, the show notes, and a link to his brand new book, The Ultimate LinkedIn Sales Guide. We're touching on the book, we're touching on social selling, we're touching on the future of just selling on the internet in general, and a whole lot more. And so that said, let's jump right into it. Daniel, welcome to the Salesman Podcast.
Will, thank you so much for having me back.
You're more than welcome, sir. You've been on, how many times have you been on the show now? You're definitely up. Victor Antonio, I think, has had the most returns. You're probably second of returns on this show, I think, moving forward now.
I think this is our third or fourth time. And obviously, we're recording the amazing Social Selling Show together. So we're spending a lot of time together, Will. I'm really excited to be back with you today.
Good stuff. Well, we're going to touch on the book, The Ultimate LinkedIn Sales Guide, throughout the conversation. We'll show the audience where they can find that and more about yourself towards the end of the show. But the title of this episode, we'll stay true to that, turning LinkedIn into a lead sales and revenue generating machine. That's what I want to dive into in this episode, Daniel. So with that, mate, one thing that you say in the book, about halfway through, I really wanted to pull out and to emphasize, because this might tee up the rest of the conversation then. You say, quote, "There is one universal truth that we know in sales. People buy from people they know, like, and trust." Now, we've all heard this, right? It's a universal truth because it's almost cliche at this point, and every salesperson has taught it from the first kind of step into sales training to their last day in their sales role. But is this know, like, and trust, is it becoming, in the internet age, the social selling age, is it becoming more or less important for salespeople?
I believe it's coming more important, Will. And it's interesting you say that it's a universal truth. There are still quite a lot of people out there that are very anti that principle, that don't believe that, you know, knowing, liking, and trusting is a valuable part of sales. But the reality is, you're not going to buy from someone you don't like. You're not going to buy, you're definitely not going to buy from someone you don't trust. And so these components are really important. Now, what's happening in sales and will continue to happen is the standards that are expected of salespeople is continuing to grow. The buyers are getting access to more and more information. The power shift is happening. And so salespeople need to level up. They need to dig deeper. And so earning that credibility, building those deeper relationships is the only way salespeople can continue to survive. And even more so with the rise of automation, AI, and all these other tools that are replacing a lot of the menial sales activities, the best thing you can do as a salesperson is show the value of you as a human being above all.
For sure. Well, these are the differentiators for salespeople against a marketing-led AI selling operation, right? Because if a buyer can buy from your organization without knowing you personally, then you don't need to exist. You, as a sales professional, do not add any value if the buyer doesn't need to know you to get a deal done. And I say you, but someone within the sales organization, right? It doesn't have to be you, depending on your territory and that side of things. The like element of it, I flip back and forth on. If I didn't like someone, but I knew they could provide a ton of value for me, then I'd still buy from them. But clearly, if I do like someone, it's going to be far easier for me to take risks, to beat the status quo, to move forward, to get people in my organization to jump on board. If I'm trying to convince Barry down the hallway, who's got the budget to buy Sarah's product, and Sarah's a complete arsehole, it's going to be more and more difficult for me to get Barry on board. Whereas Sarah's lovely, she's awesome, she's really helping me out, I'm going to be more than happy to introduce her to Barry to get these deals done. So I flip back and forth on like. So I would buy for someone I didn't like, but it makes it easier if you do. But trust has got to be the big one. Because I can't trust, if I'm buying from Amazon, I might trust that the product is probably going to arrive, but I can't go and have a go at someone, ask a question, blame someone if it doesn't, because it's just this big beast organization. So I'd be far more likely to buy if I had a customer service rep or a salesperson or someone like that with a name that I could tie to my problems or my issues. So I feel like that is the biggest competitive advantage for salespeople. You can go into a company, say, hey, you put all the risk on me. I'm going to help you through it. I'm going to help you through your buying process. And you can trust me, and if they can trust you, you can trust me to solve these issues. That's got to be a competitive advantage, right, in the marketplace where the market is trying to just push us towards automation, not actually speaking to real people, and just spam.
No, I completely agree. What's interesting is the amount we're willing to spend online without interacting with a human being, because however many years ago, spending £10 would have been really scary doing that without talking to someone. Whereas now we're willing to spend thousands of pounds without physically talking to, seeing, or having anyone there by our side. And so, and that's only going to continue to grow, which obviously as we go into B2B, those larger deal sized products, you know, there may be a time in the near future where they become a lot more transactional and a lot less consultative, but at the same time, products, prices, deal sizes are increasing as well. And so the need for people is still very much going to be there. And the value you add as a person, I completely agree. Like is probably the more looser term within it, but certainly trust. Where it becomes more relevant is the long-term relationship factor. That, you know, renewals, as we talk about recurring revenue and trying to you know, get referrals. You're not going to give a referral to someone you don't like. So those relationships, that whole like, know and trust really help cement long-term relationships, which should be the goal for most professional salespeople in the modern day.
For sure. And tying this back to social selling, this is where I think salespeople have this incredible advantage, right? I can't remember who posted it. Maybe you saw it, but there was a post on LinkedIn yesterday by kind of someone that we hang around with virtually. And it was like, it was going through the number of posts that LinkedIn corporate made each month. And it was like 30. And then was it you that posted this?
No, but I know who did.
So you feel free to shout them out. And if you don't shout them out, I'm going to assume that you hate them. But then it was like the number of corporate posts from LinkedIn was like 25. And the number of posts from LinkedIn employees was like 2,000. Number of posts from Amazon corporate, 27. Number of posts from Amazon individuals on LinkedIn, people within the organization, 2,000. There's like thousands and thousands. So this is your competitive advantage, because essentially you're competing against, in some of these organizations, your own marketing team to justify your position, to justify the hopefully insane commissions that you're making. So pulling this back to know, like, and trust into social selling. Social media is clearly the best way to build what we call trust at scale, right? We've just closed a high five-figure consulting and training deal over at salesman.org. I spoke to the VP of marketing at this company once. One phone call just to get the contracts aligned, because they wanted to use their contract. They wanted us to sign their contracts as opposed to us give them the standard contracts. This would never have happened 20 years ago. This VP of marketing has been through all our content, listens to the show, is probably listening to the show right now as we record this, and has gone back and forth in our community. So they bought the kind of individual product or the product that we have for individuals, been in the community, saw all this, communicated with me in there, and then closed this high five-figure training deal and consulting deal on the back of one phone call. That is incredible, right? That couldn't have happened before social media, and it's all because of this know, like, and trust, but not just thrown out at one person on a cold call, but at scale where multiple people can see and get involved with it. That to me is super exciting.
Oh, the impact social selling has on sales is massive. Not only can it become an inbound lead generation machine where you're going to get inquiries coming through that otherwise you wouldn't have got, but the impact it has on traditional sales is even bigger. So when you do make calls, I mean, Will, I did something very similar recently where I was approaching a CEO of a very large global company, and I did my usual send a customized connection request, had no interaction with them whatsoever. Their reply to my connection request after they accepted was, "Daniel, your reputation precedes you. Can't wait to get to know you better." Now, to have someone of the most senior leadership position in the company, the most influential person within the buying decision, already know me in a positive way is huge. And it's a huge advantage for salespeople. And as you say, a lot of companies are now pushing resources into their sales teams in terms of putting out content and building those trust. What was interesting, and going back to the post you mentioned, it does highlight how some of the biggest companies are encouraging their individuals to share content. What I can almost guarantee you is the majority of content those individuals are sharing, they're just resharing the company blog. And I know, because I work with some of those companies, they're not using it necessarily the right way. They're just regurgitating content. So volume of content is better than no content. But what we're starting to see is a lot of these companies now open their eyes to thinking, okay, maybe we don't need them to just reshare our stuff, but let's start giving them a voice. Let's start investing in their brands, their stories, because that's where the sales magic really happens.
That's the difference, Daniel, between a hack like me that sees that post and goes, that's incredible. And then someone who actually knows what they're doing and is involved behind the scenes with yourself, because I would never have even, that wouldn't have pondered my mind that 2,000 bullshit posts is probably not as useful as 27 actual kind of thought out marketing posts, perhaps.
So I had an interesting conversation with a guy called Tom Boston, who works at SalesLoft, and he's been creating these amazing videos. He's building an amazing personal brand. And we were talking about how SalesLoft as a company are now working with him to help support that continued personal brand growth. You see it with a lot of these micro influencers that are growing within these companies. And they're one of the best resources that companies have, where you get these creative people putting out content. And that is where the potential lies. Not everyone's going to be a sort of a social selling star. There are lots of ways you can use it on a more long-term basis. But when you get those people, you know, these companies are now starting to realize their value and use them as an asset. Don't look at it as a problem. Don't look at it, oh, you're wasting your time doing this. You need to bring them in, embrace it and maximize the potential.
For sure. I've talked about it on the show in the past. This has been a real bugbear for us. Now, I'll tell you why it's less of an issue in a second. But it becomes an issue for me to talk about sales when I don't have to sell anymore. Our marketing now drives more leads for the advertising, for the signups for the training product, the consulting that we do. And there's very minimal consulting. My time needs to be spent elsewhere. So it's not difficult to sell that out each month or each quarter. But I don't have to do any selling anymore. So it was a real bugbear for me. It was a real problem because how am I supposed to talk about sales if I'm not sending cold emails, if I'm not experimenting with cold calls and seeing if they're still effective anymore? And this became an issue for me like 2 or 3 years ago. Now it's solved because in our community over at salesman.org, we just test what people, we give people tests in the community and you have 1,000 salespeople saying, hey, well, I tried this and it worked, it didn't work. And we feed that back into our own training and product and service. But what I've built, which is just literally in a spare bedroom of a flat in Leeds, right, is a business that's turning over millions a year on with no selling. And I've almost engineered it out of myself, out of the business, by literally just having content online. So for a salesperson like Tom Boston, like there's countless people that are, especially in the SDR roles, that are really crushing it and creating killer content right now, they're going to end up, whether they realize it or not, with a nice little business on their hands, similar to what I'm doing, by just creating content, sharing what works, sharing what doesn't work, sharing experiments, sharing their life experiences as they go throughout their roles. And there's going to be a sea of these individuals who are going to be crushing it without actually doing all that much work in the not too distant future. Is it fair to say that, Daniel?
It is. And do you know what I love most about this, Will? Because I was talking to a sales author, someone who worked in the industry for 30 plus years, really experienced, really knowledgeable. And they almost had a bit of a chip on their shoulder about these young salespeople coming in and giving their advice and people following them. They were sort of questioning, why would you listen to someone with 3 years experience when you can listen to someone with 30 years? And what I like most, there is a point, because some people do come up and they try and sprout like they know everything. What I like most about a lot of these people, Tom, the Sarah Braziers out there, they're not going out trying to say they know everything. What they're doing is sharing their journey. And that is so valuable because it connects with other SDRs. Yes, there are amazing sales experts and authors out there that, you know, really do know a lot of stuff and you should listen to them as well. But there's going to be no one more valuable than other people in your role selling right now in the current climate, you know, not spouting stories from 20, 30 years ago, but telling you what is happening right now. You know, in 2020, during a pandemic, how can you successfully sell? Well, the best people are going to be the ones on the front line doing that. And I like that social media and LinkedIn gives these people a voice and how they're able to leverage it, not just to help their fellow peers, but to then influence and generate sales opportunities as well.
For sure. As I said, if I feel guilty 3 or 4 years into this, of not doing all that much selling because the content does it on its own, I would feel like I'd almost feel corrupt having written books for 20 or 30 years, speaking on stage and not having done any selling whatsoever. I said the only reason I don't feel bad about this, the reason I feel excited about it, is because there's 2,000 people in the salesman.org community and we run these experiments. So I've got access to data from real salespeople that you'd have to be like a Gartner to get the amount of feedback that we get regularly. Now, I'm sure the scientific method that Gartner use is a lot more sophisticated than the shenanigans that we have in the salesman.org community. But this is a problem. This is a real problem. And this is why I like the book, Daniel. So you mentioned an anecdote of working, having a reply back from a CEO of a multi-million dollar company before. That's you literally doing that. That's in the book. I've not managed to get through the whole book quite yet because you only got a copy yesterday. But that's one of the examples in the book. It's real. Now, I let me ask you this. We're kind of going off topic slightly here, but I think this is an interesting conversation for the audience. They'll enjoy this this banter. Do you read sales books?
I do.
Do you get any value from sales books? And I don't mean to drop anyone in it, but you know, be as honest as you can.
Yeah. So I'm people watching this on YouTube will see there are a lot of sales books behind me. I have read the majority of these sales books. There are some amazing sales book that genuinely I read, I apply, and I get results. There are great ones out there. I would say that's the minority. Yeah. There are also a lot of sales books that are either regurgitating stuff that has been said time and time again, others that, you know, are really kind of off the mark or poorly written. Some are just so hard to read, Will, being completely honest. I'm not going to name any of them, but yeah, there are some good ones out there, but unfortunately, it's a very heavily dominated space.
Sure. So your book is incredibly easy to read. Now, I'm assuming this is because you've produced and published so much content, whether it be the previous book and then just daily posts on LinkedIn. Have you had any training? Did Wiley, because this is traditionally published, which is awesome, right? Did Wiley come along and coach you on some of the writing? Do you have a ghostwriter? Not necessarily ghostwriter, but do you have like an editing process? How do you go about creating content for a book or for the LinkedIn process? How have you got so good at writing concisely?
I think the point you're making, Will, is that it is very simple. And that is because I've written it in a very simple way, because that's kind of how I process. I'm not trying to write something that's really intense or intellectual, because that's not me. I just want to break things down in the most easiest, simplest way so that people can read it and apply it and actually get results from it. This isn't about proving my ability to write. It's about proving my ability to help people on LinkedIn. So I wrote the book. Wiley then helped connect me with an editing team that essentially, imagine it was like a lump of clay. They helped me sculpt it and just fine tune it. But beyond that, it was kept simple for the pure reason I want salespeople to be able to use it. This isn't about me being a writer or an author. This is about me creating a guide that can actually help.
For sure. So Josh Braun is very good at this. I know you know Josh as well. He's been on the podcast loads of times. I'll include some of his previous episodes in the show notes to this episode over at salesman.org. Now, Josh used to be a primary school teacher, so he's got that teaching background. That's one of the ways he uses more traditional teaching, learning design to be able to communicate effectively on LinkedIn. I think he's growing really well on LinkedIn. He's doing publishing some great content on there as well. And he's got a training product, which I've not been through, but allegedly through my audience, is very good. So with that all said, is it just time? Is it just practice? Or should we be learning to become better at selling? Should we be learning how to teach? Should we be reading books on communication? Should we be reading and leveraging resources that are not sales specific to become better at communicating value propositions and things like this to our audience?
I could not agree with you more, Will. And it goes beyond using social selling. These are the skills that you need on the phone, through video communication, in face-to-face. You know, you need to be able to convey a message. And there is a big difference between sort of teaching and helping someone learn. It's easy to tell someone about something. That doesn't mean they process that information and understand it. Helping someone understand something is a different skill set. And that's where simplicity comes in. It's easy. Will, I could use a load of buzzwords and sound really smart about LinkedIn, but it doesn't mean you're going to understand or learn anything from that. And that's not going to make me look any better. I will look better if I can break it down in a way that you're able to then interpret it and utilize it yourself. So yeah, that is a skill. And I love that sort of school experience, you know, helps. I have kids. I've worked in sales for a long time, and there are lots of things that help me in my sort of ability to help, you know, deliver an outcome. I think that's probably the biggest tip, is to be outcome orientated, not just about delivering a message. It's not because you've said it, it's did they understand it?
Yeah, for sure. People shouldn't listen because you have done this, done that. You are a legend in the space. They should listen because it's effective. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, 100%. They should listen because it's relevant, it's current, and it can actually help you deliver a result. You can read all these wonderful books. It doesn't mean you're going to be able to apply anything afterwards. You know, look for the ones that genuinely are helping people, and there are some great ones out there.
What do you do, Daniel? When someone's read your book, they've booked you in for some training, they know what they should be doing, and then you go on their LinkedIn profile, because clearly it's public, you've probably connected with them, and they haven't done anything. What do you do to motivate? And this is relevant for salespeople who explain the steps to getting the deal done, explain the steps to solving a customer's problem, but they find that the buyer then just sticks with the status quo. They don't make the changes. We talk about risk aversion, all this kind of stuff, perhaps. But how do you motivate someone to take that bit of action towards something that they probably know they should be doing?
Well, there's a few things. This is where coaching comes in, Will. But there are three types of people. There are the ones that read the book, that do the course, and that are self-motivated, and they'll go out and do it. Then you get people at the other end of the spectrum that just have no interest. They'll flick through the book, they'll half listen to what you're saying, but they don't care. They just want to keep doing what they're doing. They're never invested in an outcome. And you get the people in the middle that are really interested, but easily distracted, find it difficult to apply. And that's where coaching comes into it. So if they haven't done it within a week, giving them a nudge. If they're struggling, maybe booking in some time and doing it with them. Now, this is something that is usually done between either me as the trainer or the sales leader, the manager, the director, whatever it may be. But a lot of it comes down to the motivation. And that's why a big part of the book and when I train and speak is to inspire people to want to do it, to sort of whet their appetite, to show them how much they can generate from it so that they have that, you know, inspiration and motivation to actually go and apply these things. It's not just one thing to teach them how to do it. You need to get them excited about it as well.
For sure. How much of this is leading by example? And what I mean by that is you go, hey, look at all this business we're doing and look at these followers I've got, and I'm only doing what I'm telling you to do every day. I'm just a few years ahead of yourself. How much of not leadership, but how much motivation just comes from leading by example?
I think quite a lot of it. And that's why I will always, and Will, you know, you're in a very good position to have all your business that have come through inbound, but it's really good that you're using your community to still gain those insights. You know, I get a lot of my business through inbound as well, but I will always be outbound selling to make sure that I'm trialing, using, modifying everything so that I am as current as can be. I don't want to be teaching things that worked on LinkedIn 5 years ago, because I guarantee you they're not going to be relevant for much longer. So yeah, leading by example is such a big thing. Whether you are a trainer, an author, a speaker, even if you're a sales leader, you need to be able to, you know, relate to them around what's happening right now.
Yeah, and because I'll tie this back to selling, of salespeople, I feel, don't use enough. And again, we've done these experiments in the salesman.org community of leading with customer success stories, as opposed to leading with our product does X, Y, Z. If you start your conversations with, we've had one of your competitors, we've had someone from a similar industry, someone that the buyer can relate to, go through these steps. I'm not the hero here. I'm just the guide. I'm just the person who's nudged them in the right direction. The customer is the hero, or the previous customer. They've been through these steps. We found that whether it's cold emails, cold calls, outreach, middle of the funnel, kind of nudging to get people back on track, these customer success stories, they've been absolutely killer. And this all comes back down to leading by example, right? I feel like this is something that is underutilized by salespeople. I don't know whether is it ego? Do salespeople like myself, are our egos too big to let other people, the other customers that we've helped, kind of be the star, the hero of the story here?
Will, I was literally just about to say this all boils down to ego. It boils down to the ego. Salesperson, the trainer, the author, and I am very aware and passionate about not letting ego influence any part of what I do. And that I've had that when I worked in sales, I had it when I was a sales leader, and I'll continue to have it in everything I do now. I think it's so important. It's not about you. It's about them. It doesn't matter how great your product is. It doesn't matter how good your company is or how well-known your company is. It's what you can do for them as an individual. And that's why the focus will always be them as a leader. It's not about how good of a leader you are. It's how much you can get out of your team and how much you can make them succeed. Their success is your success. As a salesperson, your customer's success is your success. Ego shouldn't play a part in it. And that's a big part. And again, going back to other subjects that can help salespeople, understanding how to manage your ego is a subject that often isn't trained, but it's very valuable.
For sure. Okay, so we'll wrap up the conversation with this one question, Daniel. If you could go back in time to the day that you signed up for LinkedIn and you could tell that younger, I was just about to rail on you there because we know each other from other shows that we do, right? Social selling show. I was just about to say when you could speak to that younger, less wrinkly, more useful, youthful, more energetic Daniel. Then I was just like, I don't really know that Daniel all that well to take the piss out of him on the show, but I've done it now. If you go back to your younger self, Daniel, that day that you signed up on LinkedIn, what's the one thing that you'd tell him? If you could offer just one piece of advice to that individual at that moment in time, what's the one thing that you'd tell him?
I would probably tell him to focus more on finding the niche. It took me a few years to really focus on the LinkedIn social selling piece. I went into the more broader space over the first few years. And that would be the advice I'd give. Focus on a niche. And that's the advice I give to people now. Try and find something that's unique about you. Try and find something that people can associate with you as an individual. Had I done that from day one, I could have been even further today. But, you know, no regrets or anything like that. That would be the advice I'd give.
Amazing stuff. Well, Daniel, with that, tell us a little bit about the book, The Ultimate LinkedIn Sales Guide. I'll read the full title, How to Use Digital and Social Selling to Turn LinkedIn into a Lead, Sales and Revenue Generating Machine. Daniel, tell us where we can find the book and tell us a little bit more about the book itself as well.
Yeah, so the book is the most up-to-date, comprehensive guide to LinkedIn for salespeople. It covers everything from your profile, using searches, growing networks, sending effective written audio video messages, creating engaging content, strategies, tools, processes, everything. It's available on Amazon. It's on hardback and Kindle. Audible will be coming soon in the process of getting that out. And it just is everything I've done, used to generate a ton of results from LinkedIn. And the goal for this book is to help salespeople, sales teams, companies around the world use LinkedIn better in a more authentic way. This isn't spray and pray. This isn't spamming. This is about having real conversations with the right people that create real opportunities.
Amazing stuff. The book is available on Amazon. And Daniel, where can we find out more about you as well?
DanielDisney.online, or I'm on LinkedIn.
Amazing stuff. And then I'll link to some episodes of The Social Selling Show as well. If you haven't already checked that out, me and Daniel do a weekly show. How do we picture it? I don't think we've ever sat down and described what the description of the show is. I guess it's social selling, internet selling, how to close, find and win deals via the internet. Is that fair to say?
That is fair to say. We try and cover everything that's relevant at the moment, the topics that are hot on LinkedIn and the tips and tricks that are working right now.
Amazing stuff. Well, I'll link to everything we talked about, including the book, in the show notes of this episode over at salesman.org. And with that, Daniel, legend, I appreciate you, mate. Thanks again for joining us on the Salesman podcast.
See you soon.